Just hours after members of the Electoral College cemented his victory, President-elect Joe Biden is addressing the nation tonight. We turn our attention to Politics Monday and that duo for analysis. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and host of Public Radio's Politics with Amy Walter, and Tamara Keith of NPR. She also co-hosts the NPR Politics podcast. Hello to both of you. And as we speak, Joe Biden is speaking elsewhere. We've been able to follow a little of it. Tam, I'm going to begin with you. It's been an extraordinary month since the election. Joe Biden was declared the winner a few days later, but there's been constant protests from President Trump, constant legal challenges, attempted legal challenges. Where does this leave Joe Biden right now?
Well, in many ways, President Trump's challenges and efforts to, frankly, overturn the results of the election are pretty much nearing the end of the road. Certainly with the Supreme Court refusing to take up or accept the Texas lawsuit attempting to overturn results in several key states, there aren't really any legal options left. And this leaves Joe Biden now with the Electoral College having made it official. It's no longer just the media calling this thing. It's no longer just certified results in states. It is the Electoral College. They have voted. It's official. He is the president-elect. And what we've seen in these remarks is Joe Biden, the president-elect, making an extensive case for why he won or how he won, or specifically just that he won, that he is rightfully the president-elect. It's not normal for a president-elect to have to do that, but it's also not normal for a candidate or president of the United States to refuse to concede and argue that he's going to continue fighting on and continue attempting to delegitimize the person who will follow him into the White House.
It is extraordinary, Amy, the fact that more than a month after the election, Joe Biden has to defend the fact that he won the election. But it's a measure of just how successful President Trump has been at casting doubt on the election results.
That's right. You know, during these remarks, what you hear the president-elect Biden doing is going through every single one of the challenges, not in great detail, but outlining the challenges that President Trump put forward, what the results of those challenges were, and, you know, as such, why he, Joe Biden, is the duly elected president of the United States come January 20th. You know, it's just remarkable when you think about all the ways in which the President Trump has sort of pushed the boundaries, both of our norms and our institutions. And this is also what President-elect Biden talks about in his remarks. For all the pushing and for all of the attempts to undermine the will of the electorate, everything from going to specific state legislators, high-ranking officials in the states, including governors and secretaries of state who are Republican, trying to get them to overturn the election, those institutions held, and as well as the folks who do the day-to-day work, which is a group of people that that President-elect Biden also singled out, the people who are the poll workers, the folks who showed up and counted the ballots, even as they were feeling so much pressure, both literally, maybe in some cases there were people yelling at them, or they were hearing the pressure from email and social media. And the fact that they did their jobs and did it well was a really striking sort of reality of how the strength or what the president-elect noted was, it really spoke to the strength of the American democracy, that at its local level, to the average person was the one who did the most to keep these institutions going.
And as President-elect Biden also said, there were some recounts, but there were 80-some-odd legal challenges filed, and including twice to the Supreme Court, and not a single one of them was successful. We do have a clip right now to share of a portion of what the president-elect had to say just now. Let's listen.
One of the most amazing demonstrations of civic duty we've ever seen in our country. It should be celebrated, not attacked. More than 81 million of those votes were cast for me and Vice President-elect Harris. That, too, is a record. More than any ticket has received in the history of America. It represents a winning margin of more than 7 million votes over the number of votes cast for my opponent. Together, Vice President-elect Harris and I earned 306 electoral votes, well exceeding the 270 electoral votes needed to secure victory.
So, Tam, as you and Amy have been saying, the president-elect reminding everybody he did win. He not only won, he won big. He won by the most votes ever cast, 81 million votes, 7 million more than President Trump received. I think it was something like 47% to 51%, which is a significant margin in today's divided country. But still, there is this need to prove his bona fides, in a way.
Indeed. And the reality is that President Trump is unlikely to go quietly into the night. And so President-elect Biden will be President Biden, and he's going to have a lot of work to do to reach the share of Republican voters who don't believe that he is a legitimate president. And then also he will have work to do with members of Congress. And as Biden pointed out in his remarks, more than 125 House members of Congress, Republicans, sided with President Trump and the Texas Attorney General in an effort to overturn the results in other states. And that points to the kind of work that Biden has ahead of him, the kind of division that exists in this country, but also points to the fact that President Trump still has remarkable sway over his own party. It's not clear whether those members of Congress knew that there was no chance that the Supreme Court would go along with this. And so it was sort of a free ticket to support President Trump and show their support for President Trump, or whether they thought this had a chance. People who study declining democracies have argued vigorously that letting President Trump continue the fiction is dangerous for the democracy. Biden's argument is democracy is holding just fine.
Holding just fine, Amy, and yet there is a question lingering about how much this hobbles his ability to do what he wants to do when there's been this unprecedented level of questioning raised about the legitimacy of his win.
That's right. And again, we've seen this in previous elections, right? There was consternation, obviously, after the disputed 2000 election. Many Democrats believed that George W. Bush was not put into office in a legitimate way. There were questions after 2004, questions about voting machines in Ohio, but none of those reached the levels of where we are today, and certainly did not get the stamp of approval from a president or a president-elect or leaders of the party like we're seeing today. So the question to me, Judy, is whether or not what we're seeing right now in terms of the level of loyalty to President Trump on following through on what so many of these members of Congress have to know are totally unfounded claims that they were never going to get their day in the Supreme Court, whether that goes away when Donald Trump is no longer sitting in the White House, when he's no longer tweeting at them, when he no longer has that same bully pulpit. And it also speaks to the question of whether Joe Biden, who ran on this idea that he could unify the country, whose entire campaign was premised on the idea that voters were ready to ratchet down the division, whether that's enough to bring, if not, I don't think anybody expects him to completely end polarization, political polarization in this country. But if just keeping the heat down is enough to make bipartisanship something that can at least have a chance.
Something we will just have to wait and see how it unfolds. But for now, Amy Walter, Tamara Keith, thank you both.